Welcome to Discovering. For years I've been threatening to learn how to fly fish. I just never found the time. If that sounds like you, stick around. We'll be hitting the river with fly fisherman Arlen, Sunn and Ken Huven for some lessons.
You want that fly to land on that water as natural as what a normal fly would do on that water. That comes in the material you have, that long leader.
Sit back and put your feet up. It's Monday night and time for Discovering.
The secret streams that flow beneath the cliffs of colored stone. Forests thick and healthy with birch and pine and oak. Surrounded by the greatest lakes this world has ever known. The black bear's awesome presence as he roams the hills and fields. Call of the timber wolf, the loon's lonesome trill. The eagle soaring high above, the trout lies deep and still. These are what I treasure, the only way I measure feelings that I have for this fine land. There is so much to discover when your longtime lover of northern Michigan.
Through the years, I've had the pleasure many times of filming fly fishermen. I've almost fly fished many times. I almost fly fished in California, Arizona, came really close in Colorado, and Wisconsin. And of course, I've almost fly fished here in the Upper Peninsula. I've been close enough that I could almost feel the bend in the rod.
Whoa!
I could almost feel the adrenaline and the satisfaction and the peacefulness of it all. So for years, it's almost been time to start fly fishing. I had the pleasure a while back to fish with UP fly fishermen and fly tires Arlen Sunn and Ken Huven on a small UP stream. It would be very hard to spend a day with Arlen and his river and not leave with a craving to be part of it.
And today, just to come out here and catch a few of these little brookies is just all memories.
A craving to fly fish and find my own special river that I could disappear on for an afternoon. All I know is I was tired of almost doing it. So when Arlen called and said, get some fly gear and meet Ken and I at the river, there was no more almost. My first stop was a visit with Randy at Northwoods Wilderness Outfitters to pick up the gear I needed to get me started.
The most common rod for that is a 5-weight for guys that are starting. Medium action 5-weight. Allows you to do a lot of things. You can trout fish, bluegill fish. You can even bass fish with it if you play it right. Quality of the rod, you want a decent rod, but you don't have to spend hundreds of dollars to get a decent rod now. With the new technology and the composites and the way they put these things together, rods, you can get a really, really nice rod for around $100. Reels, for trout and bluegill, you don't need a top of the line reel. You want something that's decent, but you don't need a super drag because you're probably never going to use it. Basically, it's going to be line storage, but you still don't want a cheap one. You want something that's not going to fall apart on you. And then, of course, the key to fly fishing is the fly line. You're throwing the line, not the lure. When you're spin casting, bait casting, the weight of the lure is what you're casting. And a fly rod, you're casting the line. So you want a really good line. And we tell guys, buy the best line you can afford because it is going to make a difference. A couple of the companies have put together some really, really nice outfits. We do one ourselves using a St. Croix rod. A lot of those kits, if you were to buy that stuff separately, which we have it all here to sell separately, you'd be in the $200 to $300 range. So it's a really good deal to buy an outfit if you're starting. One of the other things, we get an awful lot of guys that are dyed-in-the-wool two-piece fly rod guys. They want a two-piece. They feel that they lose sensitivity or some castability with the joint of a four-piece rod. That's not true anymore. The new technology, again, has gone so far. So basically, the difference is that a 7-piece, 9-foot rod packs into a little tube that's that's less than 20 inches long. Four-piece rods pack into tubes with the rod carriers that are around 2 feet to 2.5 feet long. And then, of course, if you have a 9-foot rod and it's a two-piece, it's going to be 4.5 feet long. It's just a transport thing. A lot of guys like the smaller rods. We like them because in our canoe packs, they slide right inside. But as far as what the average guy can tell, and even on some of the real high-end rods, you can't tell the difference between a two-piece and a four-piece anymore. So what I would recommend for you today, Brian, would be a 5-weight and a 9-foot. We've got a couple that are on sale. Again, you don't have to spend a lot of money, but you're in the $130 to $160 range.
A lot of people either rub the tip against your nose, get a little oil on there or your hair. And always, when you start your rod, always put it at about a quarter of a turn away from where you're going to lock it in. And you give it a twist as you lock it in. Now, when you take it apart, you want to do the same motion and then release it. Push down as you're doing it. I usually like to aim down my rod, make sure that everything's right in line here. Little tip on putting your fly line on. I usually go past the tippet part or the leader part, and I usually just double up the fly line itself, and it's easier to slide these through the eyelets this way. You usually want to clean your line with a silicone treatment. You don't have to do it every time, but if you're in dirtier water, it pays to clean your fly line. Keeps it in good shape and from cracking. And you can buy it in a squirt bottle, or they come in little pad. It's basically a little pad that has silicone impregnated, and you just fold that over, and here's some silicone stuff there, and you just run your line through there, and that usually cleans it off pretty good, and you're ready to go for the next time. There's different types of fly line. You can get a double tapered, which some guys like, which lets you reverse the whole fly line. After a couple of years of use, you might develop some cracks or a little bit of stuff, so you can actually reverse your fly line, and the other tapered end will be out there. On a weight forward, you only have the one end, which is weighted up. This fly line has a loop connection already made on it. Sometimes you have to tie a nail knot, a needle knot, or to tie get your leader to get a loop on the end of here. If you look in any good knot tying book or on the internet, you can find a needle knot or a nail knot, and you can make that connection. It's all in presenting the fly.
You know, you want that fly to land on that water is natural, is what a normal fly would do on that water. So you don't want to come down and slap that fly hard on the water, but that comes in the material you have. That long leader, gives that fly a chance to just set right down on the water like a natural fly would do. You want a floating line so that line is going to stay on top of the water, and that's going to help keep that fly on top of the water. If you got a sinking line, that sinking line is going to drag that dry fly right under the water. So, of course, you don't want that. You want the natural dry fly to stay on top like he's supposed to.
Purpose of the leader, it's tapered to end up rolling your fly, landing your fly softly on the water is what you're trying to do. The tippet is basically tied on the end. It's usually a little finer, and anywhere from, probably a foot to 18 inches. Some guys use a little longer, but it just saves your leader material. So when you cut off, you're cutting off on the tippet end. And when you get back to the leader, you tie a new piece of tippet on. So instead of chewing off of your leader all the time, so you can save your leader for a whole fishing season if you're careful.
And you want to be careful you don't pull it too fast. You don't want to put a drag on that fly. If that fly comes down faster than what that bubble is, that's not natural. You gotta keep everything looking as natural as possible. Once that fly starts going by you, the line is pulling it down, pick it up because it's not natural anymore. My leaders are handmade with, it'll start out at the end, be heavy, and it keeps tapering down. It'll go from like a 20 to a 10 to 15 to a 5, and then tie on a 30-inch, probably 4X. And what it does with that extra heavier leader from your line on down, that leader will just lay right out on the water. Lay right out on the water, perfect. And that tippet, like I say, I use a 4X. We all have different ideas.
Right.
And a Cortland 444 double taper, you can't beat it. It's a fugal way to go because you got two lines in one. Another thing I'd recommend is always carry some extra tippet material with you.
Right.
In case your tippet breaks off, get it hung up in a tree or whatever.
Right.
Carry that extra tippet material with you, and you can always tie on extra tippet. Ready to start flipping the fly out there. Right now I've got a little brown drake on, and the proper cast for this is, you know, go back 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and use it aggressive, really snap it out there, bring it a fly up off the water, you can just make a little loop. Get that fly floating as natural as possible, makes it look like a natural thing out there. 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and give it a little time to go back into that back loop. You want to make a good loop. You don't want to snap it. You can snap your fly right off if you snap it like a whip. You got to get used to that timing. And then just 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and let it lay down natural. I saw fish rise here right in front of us, so I got to get over on the opposite side of the river here so I don't spook them, and try to get my fly as natural as I can up above him. If you want to match the hatch early in the spring, the first thing that comes out is right here, this little blueing olive, number 16. I've had trout reject a 14 because I thought I could see it a little better. Put that 16 on, catch fish. Then you're going to get a Hendrickson, which is the real dark Hendrickson, that's the male. Then right behind that fly is going to be your female Hendrickson. Before that's even over, your big brown drake is going to start coming on. This right here is a emerger. He represents the brown drake as he's coming up off the bottom. This little tail that's hanging down is the larva coming up. He's shedding his shell.
Skeleton.
Yep.
Yeah. When they're doing a splashy rise, most of the time, the fish are feeding on emergers, and they'll reject a dry fly.
This is a helgamite. This is on the bottom of the river early in the season. These represent that big drake as he's still on the bottom of the river before he even pops up. Different streamers you can use, the gray squirrel tail, and here's a crayfish, which is very, very effective with brook trout and German browns. But my favorite fly from after the main hatches are over is my Adams. And I'll go with the 14, go with the 12. I got a 18-inch brown on the wall at home. I got with a 14 Adams. Those are my common flies. You can look at my fly box. You see all kinds of flies there, but I don't use them all. So it's always good to have a good supply of, you never know what's going to be popping up off the river. All your action is in your wrist. You don't go back with your arm. You don't do that, you're going to be tired if you do that. Just, it's all in your wrist. Your elbow to your wrist is the only thing that's moving. Good way to practice that is put a magazine underneath your elbow, and you don't want to drop that. You just keep working it just like so. And let that fly float down natural. As soon as you get a little drag on it, just a little flip with the fly rod, and a fly will come right off the water and go right back into your procedures of the 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock. And be aggressive. Flip, snap it out there. Don't be lazy with it and just drop it. You know, you want to flip it right out there so she looks natural when she hits the water. While you're doing that, you're getting the length of line out that you want. You don't want a lot of line out there because if a fish hits that fly, and you got too much line out there, he's going to spit it out before you ever get it set. So you want to fish with just the right amount of lines so that you can set it and hook that fish. Too much line, no. And then you get a sloppy cast. Once I get too much line, I'll just spin up a little bit while she's coming down. And what I like to do, say if I got a fish on, I won't even use my reel. I'll pull them in, keep that line tight, keep the line tight, get them right up close. I don't like to use my reel on taking in a fish. Very seldom I'll use the reel. And as you're coming down, you want to keep that slack line up so that if a fish hits me when my fly is down close, I got enough slack there so I can just set it he's mine. The river's flowing at you a little faster, you gotta be a little quicker on the retrieve. As you're fly fishing upstream, which is the only way to dry fly fish is fishing upstream, just get that fly up at about a 45 degree angle. And if you got a rising fish, you want to drop that fly about 3-4 feet above them, at least sometimes 5 feet above them, because where he came up is not where he's permanently at. He'll see a fly and he'll let himself release and he'll come downstream, then come up and take that fly. So where you see the rise, that's not where he's camped out. He's up the river just about 3-4 feet farther up. So you want to get that fly well up ahead of him. And you want it to float as natural as possible. Once you get a little drag on it, pick it up, put it back out there again. Another thing too, if you got a rising fish, don't hurry up to him, because you might throw a little wake, a little current over him. He'll shut right down. He'll go back to his cover. So you always want to, it's almost like deer hunting. You want to be sneaking up on them. And you don't want to expose, you know, and it's good to wear dark clothes. Don't wear bright clothes on the river. Fish can see very, very well. And I've read where German browns can be looking up the river and they can see what's all around them. They can see all around them. Do your false casting up over the river, not over where you're going to be fishing. You false cast over a rising fish, he's going to go down. He's going to take cover. So dry your fly off with a false cast up the river, away from that hole, away from that rising fish. All the predators for fish are above them. So anything that's not doesn't look natural to them, they'll go to cover. I had a pool one time with a lot of fish rising, and around the corner come a bald eagle. They never did start up again that afternoon. They went right to cover when they seen that big eagle come over. My false cast is generally what I'm doing is drying my fly off so she'll float better. Even though you got flotation on there, you know, you got that little gink on it, that fly is going to suck up some water, so just throw a few false casts up and that dries that fly right out. She'll lay there much more natural.
As far as the floatant I use the gink. There's lots of different ones out there. There's powder ones. This is a silicone one. Little droplet of that stuff, and if you rub it in good, get it saturated up. If you want it to float nice and high, I usually just give a little bit on the line first few inches. That usually keeps it nice and high.
You see that fish that hit me in there and I missed him? He won't hit again. No, no. He learned his lesson. He was smarter than I was. Yeah, I always keep my fly rod off like on about a 45 degree angle. I don't come straight over my head. No, it's off on an angle, about a 45 degree angle. Yeah. And a lot of it depends on the width of your river and what you're fishing for the tag elders that are around you. You got to be very much aware of what you're fishing up against. I get her out, get her coming down, keep stripping that line back, keep stripping that line back, so you always have tight line. You don't want any slack in that line. If a trout hits that, even if you got slack in that line, you're not going to set them. Keep stripping, get her up so far and you're safe. Keep coming back. If a fish hit me right there now, bingo, I'd have them. Yep. Since I retired and moved back home and spending a lot of time on the river, I've educated myself, and a fish will educate you as well. But yeah, the more you fish, it's like anything, you know. You learn the fundamentals of how the fish act, how they feed, when they feed, and what they're feeding on. You know, a lot of it is what they're feeding on. Like when you got your dominant hatches, you've got to have that fly that they're feeding on. It's just like you walking into a restaurant, you're gonna look for the plate that you want. You're not gonna take something that you don't like. With a trout, it's the hatch, it's the fly that's on the water, and that's the one they're gonna eat.
Well, we didn't catch any fish, but as I suspected, it didn't matter. I was here to learn a bit about fly fishing, to experience it for myself, to see if it is indeed what I'll have described it to be. So what's my take on fly fishing now? Well, at the end of the day, we'd caught no fish. Arlen and Ken were back at the truck. And there I was, standing in the middle of a quiet stretch of river with a fly rod, dying to throw just one more cast. I was already planning my next day of fly fishing. Today I almost caught a fish. And that's just fine by me.